sing, 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 sing. Everybody start to sing. La-di-da, ho, ho, ho. Now you're singing with a swing.
Tony guarda in alto il cielo azzurro sulla città. È una luce che riscalda tutto e oggi sembra diversa. Facce senza nome sono volti induriti dal tempo. E la polvere risponde sempre, parole nel vento. Tu non l'ascolterai, non far rumore. Tu non la canterai. Nemmeno ora. Ehi, 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 ehi. Italiani veri superstar al di là del mare, tra bugie di verità bruciano d'America. Italiani veri superstar al di là del mare, tra miseria e santità bruciano d'America. Sta-di-da-di-da-da, sta-di-da-di-da-da-da-da. Opa, opa, starirarirarang, starirarirarang, ta. Opa, 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 starirarirarang, starirarirarang, ta. Opa, 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 starirarirarang, starirarirarang, ta. Frankie parla piano e racconta le vite passate. Beve vino, carte, nostalgia delle terre lasciate. Angelo non parla mai e si nasconde soltanto. E la polvere risponde sempre, parole nel vento. Tu non l'ascolterai, non fa rumore. Tu non la canterai, nemmeno ora. Ehi, 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 ehi. Italiani veri superstar, al di là del mare. Tra bugie di verità, bruciano d'America. Italiani veri superstar, al di là del mare, tra bugie di verità, bruciano d'America. Starirarirada, starirarirada-da-da-da. Opa, opa, starirarirada, starirarirada-da-da. Opa, 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 starirarirada, starirarirada-da-da. Opa, let's shit mobo, starirarirada, starirarirada-da-da. Ascolterai, non fa rumore, tu non la canterai, nemmeno ora.
Peppe Voltarelli's work is described as a modern Italian's musical take on the diaspora of tight-knit Italian communities that continue to thrive throughout Europe and the Americas. His New York debut is part of a Pan-American tour in which he will perform songs from his first solo album, Distratto ma però.
Mi sembra che di recente c'è un flusso di artisti italiani che sembra che ci sia una certa empatia per l'emigrato e che forse siete stati colpiti da artisti italo-americani.
Ma l'epopea degli italiani all'estero non è mai finita, insomma, l'epopea, la grande epopea italiana continua e in questo periodo gli italiani sono molto interessati a suonare all'estero perché gli orizzonti si stanno sempre più allargando.
C'era un tempo che la musica italiana era molto apprezzata, no? C'è forse che negli anni 60 e poi c'era anche il... Nel blu dipinto di blu di Modugno, volare, di cui hai fatto sì. Pure uno spettacolo, che ci sono stati, che non so, 60 versioni di quella canzone. Sì. Ma, e tu pensi che c'è quel periodo, cioè un periodo così può tornare.
Abbiamo avuto anche il periodo degli anni 70, appunto con la musica progressive, dove avevamo delle band internazionali come la PFM, le Orme, che hanno ispirato anche tanti gruppi stranieri. Adesso io credo che noi, che molti artisti italiani stiano cercando un'identità all'interno della nostra lingua, della nostra espressione, e probabilmente fra poco i tempi saranno maturi per ascoltare una nuova espressione autentica italiana, perché la cosa interessante è sempre il rapporto tra autenticità e poetica, no? Quanto questa poetica, come dire, può essere espressiva e può raccontare bene la tua terra. Per questo, ad esempio, io canto in italiano, canto in calabrese, ma lo faccio anche ispirandomi a questi, come dire, modelli, questi padri storici come Modugno, come Tenco, come Sergio Endrigo, che sono delle persone che hanno raccontato un'Italia anche, un'Italia importante, del boom economico, un'Italia vogliosa di fare, che adesso forse noi sentiamo che c'è questa necessità anche adesso. Noi in pratica ci ispiriamo un po', come dire, a questo atteggiamento ironico, no? Ma questo modo di scherzare sull'italianità, sul modo di vestire, sui baffi, sul nostro accento che è proprio forte, sì. Sul nostro modo di parlare inglese, che è sempre un inglese ai confini con il dialetto, no?
I have a song that I want to play tonight because it's in dialectic. I never played this song before in USA. It's the first time if someone wants to copy, can do it. Yes. You can deposit it to the CIA. You can get money, but you remember for me. When you get money from the song, you think that there is a man that is alone in San Diego, because I would like to go to live to San Diego, that is poor, and you are rich for his song. Yeah, it's called "O País Ricuch." It means the town of the, I don't know the chuch, what you say chuch. Anki, yes, Anki. Anki. Vabbè. Comunque, we call the chuch in Italy. It's the one that is close to the cow in the presepe of Christmas. It's the man, is the animal that everybody don't look at him, because everybody look to the Jesus Christ is born. But the one on the right is called Chucho. Yes. And the song is called "O País Ricuche." O País Ricuche. O País Rimort. O País Ricente. O País Ricente. Bell, 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 bell. Boom, boom. O país ricerto, o país ricruxa, o país rimama, o país ripado. Bel, 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 bel. Bom, 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 bom. Bel, 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 bel. Bom, bom, bom. Bona, bona, bona. E non voglio vivere, no! 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 In tuo paese ricciuc, io, io! Un paese ricciuc, io, io! Un paese ricciuc, io, io! Un paese ricciuc, io, io! Figlia o gatto guarda in teos, figlia emerge senza sottotel. Hanno capito che quando si scampa non si campa mas more. Hanno capito che quando si mangia non si campa mas more. More, 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 more. Io non voglio more, no. Io non voglio more, no. Io non voglio more, no. in Vodimozhno. Into Pais Richut, who 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 Pais Richut. Grazie.
E c'è tutta una nuova ondata di questi artisti che secondo me appunto ha voglia proprio di riprendersi questa gioia anche di sperimentare, di cantare. È un'arte impegnata, ecco, un'arte impegnata che, come dire, ti fa raccontare il tuo momento, come facevano forse una volta i cantastori che salivano sui treni, andavano nel West a raccontare la costruzione delle ferrovie, come faceva Woody Guthrie, come faceva Bob Dylan, come facevano i nostri cantastori, Matteo Salvatore, lo stesso Domenico Modugno, i grandi della musica popolare, Rosa Balestriere, Otello Profazzi, cioè questi nomi che sono rimasti nella storia, che ancora oggi se vai nella comunità italiana e se vai nei negozi di dischi a cercare la musica italiana trovi i dischi di Matteo Salvatore, di Modugno, di Rosa Balestrieri, di questi monumenti, diciamo, della musica.
La tua rabbia da dove viene?
La mia rabbia viene da un posto che si chiama Calabria, che si trova vicino alla Sicilia. È un posto del Mediterraneo in mezzo al mare dove molta gente è dovuta andare via perché non trovava lavoro e perché trovava una società ingiusta, da cui doveva scappare necessariamente, e ha cercato fortuna dovunque nel mondo, dal Canada agli Stati Uniti all'Argentina, alla Germania, e quindi è una rabbia storica ormai, non è una rabbia di 5 minuti, è una rabbia di un popolo che penso in piccolissima parte di raccontare anch'io nella mia quotidianità.
Uomini di panza! Uomini di cuore, uomini di fede, di sangue e d'onore, canta rugaggio, le scotole le pinne, non si vira la luna e non si vira neanche i steed, ma io voglio vivere ancora, ma io voglio scendere ancora, ma io voglio credere ancora. Boom boom boom, tre botte dentro scuro, boom boom boom, una lama dentro cuore, boom boom boom, t'hanno lasciato solo, boom boom boom, una lama dentro cuore, tararirarara, 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 dai 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 dai, tararirarara, 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 dai dai dai. Uomini di panza, uomini di cuore, uomini di fede, di sangue e d'onore, canta rugaggio e scotola le pinne, non si vede la luna e non si vedono manchi i stit. Uomini di panza, uomini di cuore, uomini di fede, di sangue e d'onore, canta rugaggio e scotola le pinne, non si vede la luna e non si vede neanche i stit, ma io voglio vivere ancora, ma io voglio scendere ancora, ma io voglio credere ancora. Boom boom boom, tre botte dentro scuro, boom boom boom, t'hanno lasciato solo, boom boom boom, una lama dentro cuore, boom boom boom, tre botte dentro scuro, tararirarara, 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 tararirarara,
quindi racconto questa esperienza di fuga, diciamo, più che una rabbia di un fuggitivo.
Ci sono delle canzoni che ti metti subito a scrivere in calabrese?
Ma il dialetto c'ha un suono che è molto originale. Il dialetto c'ha un suono che sembra quasi proprio un suono ancestrale, arcaico, un suono che non ha un'esistenza scritta, è una lingua orale, quindi alcune volte il canto nasce spontaneamente in dialetto e mi è capitato tante volte di scrivere dopo aver cantato delle cose in dialetto, ma in una lingua strana che poi è il dialetto, che però da cui poi nasce la parola in italiano spesso, no? E quindi alcune volte scrivere in dialetto è proprio spontaneo, immediato e senza filtri.
Stavo ascoltando L'anima volata.
Ma L'anima volata è un pezzo, tra l'altro, che nasce da un momento magico, perché l'abbiamo scritta e suonata insieme con Sergio Cammariere, che è un grande artista italiano, che ha suonato il pianoforte in questa canzone, composto insieme a me. E siamo entrambi di origine calabrese, siamo entrambi dello stesso posto, per cui poi il pianoforte non è uno strumento, diciamo, della tradizione contadina, ecco. Quindi sentire il dialetto cantato sul pianoforte ti dà un po' un senso di, come se, a me sembra un po' che come se la lingua si fosse evoluta, come se la lingua fosse diventata nobile, fosse entrata magari, sai, in un posto dove non era mai entrata, in un posto magico. Esprime, insomma, la sua, come dicevi tu, il suo attaccamento proprio con la terra, la sua essenzialità. Non c'ha, ci sono alcuni termini in dialetto che non si possono tradurre in italiano, per cui tanta gente ha ripreso a scrivere, a comporre e a cantare in dialetto, e adesso c'è una situazione molto interessante, perché ci sono dei posti dove proprio se non c'è il gruppo che canta in dialetto, la gente non va a vedere il concerto. Sembra quasi che anche i rockers debbano fare rock in dialetto.
Turismo in quantità, di che cosa parla?
La canzone Turismo in quantità è un gioco che nasce in un posto di mare come Mirto, che è il mio paese, dove noi abbiamo sempre avuto il desiderio di avere dei turisti. Facciamo questo turismo.
L'aria buona, il sole ci riscalda, la terra brucia, l'erba cresce ai lati della strada, l'aereo a terra sull'onda che travolge le case abusive, ma c'è la processione, tutti in fila, nessuno se ne accorge. Ci vuole rispetto, molto rispetto per le tradizioni, le radici da mangiare per dimenticare, auto, ricambi, colazioni, bibite, panini, matrimoni, cresimoni, lampade, gioielli, tagli di capelli. Ci sono giornali, frutta, patate, funghi, pesce fresco, sale da ballo, curve, parcheggi, bomboli di gas. Turismo in quantità, turismo in quantità, turismo in quantità, turismo in quantità, turismo in quantità.
Sogno di civiltà. Però è un po' ironica, perché racconta anche di quanto spesso questa volta è questa cosa che noi facciamo è un po' ridicola, perché non riusciamo ad essere autonomi e ad organizzarci con le nostre risorse, non quello che abbiamo giù, e quindi pensiamo al turismo di Miami Beach o della California o di Rimini, invece di pensare a preparare semplicemente una fresina col pomodoro e un po' d'olio, che piacerebbe molto di più, insomma.
Sei andato a fare un concerto nell'Iraq?
Sì, nel 2002 a Baghdad, un concerto per la pace, prima della guerra, abbiamo suonato all'Hotel Palestine. Ed è stata un'esperienza molto forte, perché abbiamo visitato Baghdad, abbiamo suonato anche in alcune scuole per i bambini, abbiamo visitato degli ospedali, e chiaramente suonare in un paese che era in embargo già da 20 anni è stata una cosa molto difficile. Però portiamo dentro di noi, eravamo 20 artisti, un gruppo di 20 artisti, portiamo dentro di noi ancora il ricordo di una grande esperienza umana, no? Perché spesso se vivi in Occidente, sai, vivi il rapporto con questi paesi lontani come se fosse una cosa che non esiste, no? Invece essere stati là ci ha dato l'idea del fatto che il popolo iracheno è vivo, è vegeto, e tutte le mattine si alza per andare per andare a vivere, a lavorare, a andare a scuola e tutto. E noi è stata una grande esperienza quella dell'Iraq. Dopo 3 mesi del nostro concerto a Baghdad è scoppiata la guerra e lì ci siamo resi conto che la guerra è un'assurdità, è una cosa assolutamente pazzesca, ingiusta.
Ti interessa molto il tema dell'emigrazione?
Ma il mio rapporto con l'emigrazione e con il popolo degli emigranti è un rapporto molto stretto, nel senso io sono molto legato alla comunità italiana all'estero, sono legato alla comunità in Germania, ci ho vissuto, sono legato alla comunità del Bronx e cerco nella comunità di capire le mie origini, di capire le origini della mia gente, di capire il significato di questi lunghi viaggi, di queste grandi distanze che l'emigrazione ha costruito, che l'emigrazione dove l'emigrazione ha vissuto e dove la nostra storia si è spalmata, si è trasformata, si è combattuta. E in queste lunghe distanze poi si ritrovano delle persone che sono dei simboli, no? Dei simboli di bellezza, di bravura, di passionalità, di cattiveria, di leggerezza, di pesantezza. Si trovano degli archetipi e tantissime storie, tantissimi fatti da raccontare, personaggi, facce. E per questo il mondo dell'emigrazione è un mondo vivo pregnante, un mondo pieno di cose che noi dovremmo prendere anche come esempio, studiare, approfondire per conoscerci meglio, soprattutto per conoscere meglio anche quello che succede adesso che gli emigranti vengono dall'Africa piuttosto che dalla Bangladesh, dai paesi poveri, e capire che siamo più o meno la stessa cosa. Questo è importante perché ti fa capire che le differenze sono soltanto nella nostra mente.
Grazie.
Un servo tempo fa dentro una chiazza pregando a Cristo un croce lì dicita: Cristo non mi patone, mi sapazza, mi tratta come un cane pila via, si piglia tutto con la sua manazza, manco la vita mia, dici che è mia, distruggila Gesù, sta mala razza, distruggila Gesù, fallupe mia, fallupe mia. Tu ti lamenti, ma che ti lamenti, piglia lo bastone e tira fuori i denti. Tu ti lamenti, ma che ti lamenti, piglia lo bastone e tira fuori i denti. Tu ti lamenti, ma che ti lamenti, piglia lo bastone e tira fuori i denti. Tu ti lamenti, ma che ti lamenti, piglia lo bastone e tira fuori i denti.
Grazie.
I'm Lucia Grillo with Italics. We're at the Knitting Factory in Brooklyn, New York, where the legendary band Killing Time is playing the record release show for their long-awaited album, Three Steps Back.
What you just saw was footage from the recent record release party at Brooklyn's Knitting Factory for Killing Time's new album, Three Steps Back. With me to talk about the album are members of the legendary New York hardcore band. Anthony Drago on drums, Anthony Comunale on vocals, Christopher Skowronski on bass, and Carl Porcaro on guitar. Guitarist Rich McGloughlin couldn't be with us. Guys, thanks for being with us tonight. Tell us about the origins of the band, how you met, how it all came together.
Anthony Drago, myself, Rich McGloughlin, had a band called Breakdown. And we put a demo tape out, we recorded it in 1987. And in 1988, we hooked up with Anthony Comunale, who had been singing in a band called Token Entry. And Mike Senkowitz, who had been playing in a number of bands, New York Hoods, Schmegma, I think he played it Sick of It All for a little bit. We met up the first practice, we got together, and it just was. There was no question, I think, after maybe an hour that I was going to be a band and we were going to move forward. We hooked up with each other through a place called Some Records, which was a little basement spot. I think it was on 5th Street, right off Bowery, and it was just... It was where everyone in hardcore went.
What are your individual musical influences?
For me, it was always simply a progression of finding the next thing that was harder, faster, more in your face. So like it started with, you know, whatever the first things you heard, the, you know, the meanest sounding classic rock, right through getting involved in metal, then thrash metal, then first hearing hardcore was such a revelation that it was like kind of everything else was jettisoned for that point, you know, and it was straight on, you know, at CDs every weekend, starting up the band and everything. So that's the trajectory of what I was into. You know, started off pretty much with heavy metal. And a lot of the heavy metal guys were starting to talk about hardcore. And I remember in Rolling Stone, there was a big article on some of the SST bands from California. And you started to kind of hear about this stuff. You hear about, like, you know, the DC hardcore bands. And, you know, next thing you know, that's, like, all you wanted to hear.
I was into disco. Like, around 79, 1980, I heard the Sex Pistols. You know, the kids at school were making fun of me because I was, like, the only homeboy in my school. I heard the Sex Pistols in 1979 and 1980 and took it from there. I got my influences at that point were definitely classic punk and hardcore. Then I started discovering, you know, towards, I guess, 1984, 85, I would start listening more to, you know, like MC5 and New York Dolls and things like that, and Iggy. And then that whole swing scene, I was always a big fan of Frank Sinatra, and then we got into the big band and, you know, Royal Crown Review and stuff like that. Which was actually made up a lot of old hardcore people too, all the original swing scene.
I listened to a lot of metal. I had a brother who was 10 years older than I was, so right around 79 or 80. He was like 19 or 20 and he got me into Sex Pistols and Ramones, Television. Some of that kind of stuff. And then on my own, I started finding out a lot about California punk rock, like Suicidal and Black Flag and stuff like that. And then around, you know, maybe 85 or 86, I really started hearing a lot about the local New York scene. I was listening to a lot of California punk at that time and a lot of metal still. And just kind of like Carl said, once I really kind of that, maybe it was just the age, like being 17 or 18, once I, the hardcore was so much more extreme than anything else that I just kind of just went with that, you know, pushed everything else aside. But now I still, you know, I go back and listen to a lot of old 70s rock and metal, Thin Lizzy, stuff like that. I like a lot of 70s power pop still, like Cheap Trick, things like that. But yeah, all sorts of things.
I was basically like weaned on like Bob Dylan and Johnny Cash when I was young. And I got really close to the lyrics and stuff that people needed to get across, and that's really what matters to me a lot. And in my younger years, I guess I was like really into metal. I had a brother and a sister growing up in the house, and that's what we listened to. On one night I saw the Circle Jerks playing on Rock Palace on the TV, and I saw Chuck Biscuits drumming for him, and I was just like, this guy's insane, he's out of his mind, and I gotta learn how to play like that. Before that I was playing, you know, to Ronnie James Dio in my basement and trying to keep like a 4-4 beat together, and then I saw this guy go absolutely nuts, and I said, that's where I gotta be. And since then I just kept on going and exploring different things, got into punk rock and expanded with this band, and basically pretty much what I like listening to is my band at this point.
What drew you guys to this hard sound and these lyrics, these type of lyrics?
Every song is pretty personal about what we deal with. I write about stuff that deals specifically with me. I mean, the band isn't political at all. I'm not really trying to get some kind of point across to anybody, because I really don't think that that's my place to do. All music is for me is a way to share my thoughts with somebody else. It's an artistic way to put it across, and it's a way to make it last forever.
One thing that was great about hardcore was, you know, everyone has the same, like Drago's lyrics, you know, I sing them and I feel them, you know, and just like the kids that listen to it and you know, they come up to you or get in touch with you on Facebook and tell you, oh, you know, you guys got me through my teen years, and you know, I felt like that, or I feel like this, and you know, it's great. That's the one great thing about hardcore. There was no separation, and you know, you could really communicate.
That's the incredible part about the kind of music that we play is it's so open. Everybody is so open-minded that you can't really piss anybody off. You know, it's your feelings. Nobody's going to put you down for saying it, what you feel. Nobody's going to, you know, do anything against you. And it's a great way to express yourself. And I couldn't think of a type of music that's more accepting than hardcore.
I think like when you're a teenager, there's something really attractive about the kind of music where it's somebody's
bitching.
Yeah, just like pissed off and screaming. I mean, I think everybody gets into hardcore, or at least I know we all did at a certain time in your life, when it's there's something just great about being able to go out there and like scream something as loud as you possibly can, and like Drago and Anthony said, like, you know, people are going to accept it, and you can just kind of say what you feel. I think every teenager wants to just yell at the top of his lungs about everything that he's pissed off about.
That's what's great about hardcore. Is like, you know, back when I started originally going to shows, like around 1981. All the bands, we were all kids, you know, basically. There were a couple of guys that were older, you know, a couple of the guys in like the Mob were older, and the Bad Brains, but for the most part, you know, Murphy's Law, you know, with the exception of Al, was a good friend. You know, my band, I was in the third singer for Gilligan's Revenge, Young and the Useless, the Beastie Boys, everyone was, you know, 13 and 14 year old kids, 15 year old kids, you know. What other music is there where, you know, it's kids watching kids, supporting kids, putting out fanzines, putting out records? You know, it was definitely a young scene, which is kind of weird, right, playing nowadays. Yeah. You know, we're like, I'm 43 years old, and you go out there and you're playing like, you know, 13 or 14 year old kids. It's kind of funny, you know, but it's, you still kind of feel, you know, that attachment, you know, to the lyrics, I guess.
It's not much of a jump, you know, jumping from, you know, teenage angst to like middle age.
Yeah, it's the same, the same thing.
What is it like looking out there and seeing these kids that are so far from you, age-wise?
It's totally rejuvenating. It gives credence to the fact that what you're doing, you're not out there just, you know, a bunch of old dudes just fucking around playing some old songs you used to play. You're playing some songs that are fresh from a bunch of young kids, and they're into them, and they want to see people that wrote them playing them, and they want to like get on stage and they want to sing along. It makes everything, you know, totally. It makes it viable. It's really the reason to go out and do it. I mean, it's cool also to see all the old heads and the ones that will still come out and see the show. But, you know, and it's great to have that combination. Be able to go out and see your old friends, see people you knew that were in bands coming up, you know, see people that were always hanging out, and then see a whole new generation, too. And then, you know, we've been doing it so long, this little generation in the middle, too, you know. That generation is probably the dude that put on the show.
What is the difference between when you were that age and now, or similarities?
It's a lot more accessible for people nowadays. You know, when we were younger, you know, into punk or hardcore, you really had to seek it out. You know, like a lot of the original hardcore bands, you know, like people that got into hardcore got in through skateboarding. you know, and because like the original punks were totally different than hardcore. They were like older guys, you know, a lot more drugs, a lot more partying, where hardcore were more like, you know, kids, like the younger brothers. Like my older sister was a punk rocker. You know, we were like the younger brothers and sisters of, you know, these punks. And it was just, you know, you had to seek everything out. You know, you had to go down to the Lower East Side for records. You had to go down to the Lower East Side to see a show, you know, the Mud Club. And you never had a problem getting into these places. But, you know, for the most part now, you go to the mall, you go online, you download it. It's, you know, it's not as... as fun. I mean, when we were kids, if you were sitting on a train and you saw a kid with a crew cut or a shaved head or a spiked hair, you'd be like, wow, you know, you'd have a connection and you'd wind up talking and this and that. Now everyone looks the same, you know, everyone's got tattoos, everyone's covered in, you know, everyone's got a shaved head or spiked hair.
It was a commitment. You had to put effort into being able to just find a record. You would have to travel and find a place that might possibly sell the obscure record that you were into, and then still not, you know, be able to get it. Like Anthony said, you would see someone that was dressed a certain way or had a certain band t-shirt, and it was like you were part of something that no one else really knew about.
One of the key differences is something between something that's manufactured for consumption with a profit motive, versus all these bands that we mentioned before, all these New York hardcore bands, when they got into it, there was no... You had no chance of achieving anything other than to make it in the scene, which meant that you were going to be
friends
with all your friends, and everyone was going to like you, and you were all screaming lyrics together. You're going to go crazy. And that's the way the scene was. That people were coming at it from their hearts and from their creativity. And, you know, that's all they could hope for is an outlet. You know? And that's what it was about.
Yeah, completely. It was like all in the moment and just for its own sake.
You know, we talk about this new record. It really was made for the sake of making the record for us expressing ourselves.
These guys were writing such killer music that it inspired me to, you know, write lyrics, put this out, make it as exciting and fast and punk as humanly possible. All done in my parents' garage, where we all met, where we all started getting this stuff together, and you know, that's where it belongs. Like that's where punk rock is for me, in my parents' garage. That's where I met these guys, where I live with these guys, where we shared so much together.
The thing that always struck me, your sound was different. It had a musicality about it. Yeah. You were not just kids who wanted to, you know, shout and get aggression out, but actual musicians.
Talking about like Bright Side, that was like all of us together, but on the last record, that's this kid and this kid, because they amazing, the songs that they came up with. I mean, these guys took all of those songs on the new record, I mean, either writing them solo or collaborating. I mean, that's amazing when they bring that to me and then I'm just kind of like playing along. Work's already done. And I was so amazed with what they did on this new record. And Chris coming into the band was just like, I mean, just pushed it over the edge. I mean, talk about the kind of, people have said like the new album's a little bit more punk rock rather than hardcore. It's got a little bit more of a melodic feel. I like completely attribute most of that to Chris and his songwriting on the new album. I thought it was just something new. And Carl too, I mean, it was crazy.
Coming from outside of the band, I have a different perspective because I was like a fan, a friend, but also a fan for so long. So I heard them as someone who wasn't in the band. I always thought that Killing Time's songwriting, I thought was just way beyond anybody else's. I mean, the lyrics were on a completely different level. The Anthony's voice was so recognizable, and the guitar riffs. I mean, I just felt like there was something. I don't want to say poppy about it, but I mean, the songs were catchy. They were just like, they were good songs that were well structured. They were arranged well. They stuck in your head, but they were still hardcore. So I felt like there was like a craftsmanship that Killing Time had about songs that other bands didn't. Where other bands were kind of throwing stuff together and saying, okay, we have the mosh part, we have this part. I think that's one of the reasons why people still love Brightside. It's like you can listen to it, and they're good songs. You know, 20 years later. Reasons I was so excited to finally get to play with them is because I just thought they were the best at that, what they were trying to do, you know?
Now you guys, how Italian-American are you? And how does that affect, influence your music?
Grandparents were all born here. I don't know, I'm so Americanized, it's, except Christmas Eve, you have your fish and, you talk with a little accent. You say galamad, you say mozzarella. That's about it. Talk with your hands.
Oh, man. I'm half Italian. My dad's from Sicily. He came to the country in the 60s. And my mother's from Northern Ireland. So they met at a little mixer in White Plains where I was born. Not exactly in this island. But when I was growing up, my father's family worked is like one would come over and work for the other until they had enough to bring the other one over on the plane. So they would just come here to America and work and then bring over each relative as they went. And they built, I guess, like a small community in this little Westchester suburb where I grew up. And when we were young, we did everything with family. I mean, my father came from a family of four brothers and five sisters. So he was one of 10. And I had so many cousins. I still have so many cousins. And they've grown so many cousins. But
they planted with the tomatoes.
Grown some cousins.
Exactly. So I never learned Italian in my house. But as I remember growing up and being Italian and being in that that type of atmosphere, it was great.
Was it encouraging towards your music?
My father's still proud of what I've accomplished, but that's about it. As far as understanding and stuff, it's a different generation. And I don't attribute that to him being Italian.
My grandfather came here on the boat. My father was born here. So my Italian-American culture is very much Americanized. We have the food.
Yeah. The family.
We have the food, we have the family, but we don't have that same kind of tight immigrant clan.
Well, you know why?
That people from the first generation have. But, you know, in terms of like, a lot, there's so much that stays, you know what I mean? From the old country, my family was musicians. And my grandfather was running around with his four-piece band in City Island, New York, during the Great Depression, and that stuck with my father, you know. And I ended up with an accordion in my hand.
He was trying to
get me to play "Lady of Spain" when I was a little kid, and I totally rebelled against it. But but it made me know that I could play music,
yeah.
And I went right down to the store where we got the accordion in the Bronx. We traded it in for a cheap Gibson SG copy. So I mean, that was influential in some way. That's what got me started in playing music.
My mother's side of the family was Italian, and but it was Italian American. I mean, it was like a diluted kind of thing, like Anthony said. So we don't say mozzarella, And on Christmas Eve, you're gonna have squid and octopus and little square hostie dip, just little things like that. But for the most part, they were Italian Americans. They were loud, Sunday, my mother's cooking sauce that starts on Saturday, and it's like, it's simmering all day, and you're gonna have Sunday dinner at 3 instead of 6 o'clock, and we got together with a lot of family, I don't think it influenced music in me.
Nah.
Except for the fact that the Italian side of my family was loud and kind of boisterous and exuberant and kind of love life more, and the other side of my family is Polish, which is much more, Eastern Europeans are very stoic and really serious, yeah. And so the Italian side was just more about having fun and being
more animated.
Expressing yourself, more animated, exactly. And so I think that lent itself to maybe want to play music.
Was your hardcore playing encouraged?
My band used to practice in my basement.
Yeah. Yeah.
My first band, and then Drago's, I mean, his parents used to let us use their garage.
Like,
that one thing about the Italians, they always like to have the family around. You know, that's
exactly.
Yeah,
like,
that's
right?
One thing. Like, everyone can come to my house.
I would do that
friends.
Before, like how my father might not be.
They're smack.
I would do that before, like my father may not understood what I was doing, but he always offered my ability to do it, and actually offered up a space where we could all do it.
And you could live
as long as
you
knew where I was, and he knew. You know, I wasn't messing up.
I don't think my parents were thrilled about it, but they never said, you can't do it. I mean, they pushed hard to make sure I would go to college to have some kind of a fallback plan, but, you know, they never stopped it.
So let's get to the new album. One of my favorite songs is Mingus, which refers to a quote by a jazz great, Charles Mingus.
Yeah.
Making the simple complicated is commonplace, making the complicated simple, awesomely simple, that's creativity.
We got back from Japan and we were saying, all right, we're going to settle down and we're going to put out this record and we're going to put something together. So I want to make this simple. So that's where the lyric came. I want to make this awesomely simple, like Mingus. I want to think of new things, and I want to put it in a way that anybody could understand. And basically, the song goes on to explain the way I felt over my life, about people not understanding how important the music is to me, how important the outlet of writing the lyrics are to me. It's kind of like an FU to people who don't understand why I do what I do. And even if you don't think it's important, it's nothing to look down upon. And just give me my freedom to do what I want to do, and let me do it well.
Cheap thrills, bright side, fools die, tell tale, what I want, no more Mr. Nice Guy, my reason, backtrack, wall of hate. 8 of the 10 songs from your first album, Bright Side, have gone down as New York hardcore classics. What do you think attributed to the album's this extraordinary success?
Definitely the musicians and the lyrics, you know, mainly. I mean, you know, I had a lot of friends. These guys were great musicians. I mean, you know, Drago wrote great lyrics. I wrote a couple of lyrics on it. I mean, everything just, you know, fit together. And just, you know, I think it was the right time and, you know, the right place and the right style of music. You know, it's like when I went to that garage that day and heard Telltale, it was kind of reminiscent of Breakdown, but the rest of the stuff that they wrote really, you know, it was something totally different. And as much as I like Breakdown, I just thought it was, you know, so much better and so much harder. Just took on a life of its own. You know, we played our first show opening up for Sick of It All, and then we were offered our second show was to do the Super Bowl. It was like the first Super Bowl. And then, you know, from there, it just, you know, kept going. And then next thing you know, Relativity Records wanted to, you know, give us a deal.
I don't know what it is about the first album. It was just our album. It was named
I mean,
our garage.
And where we were at and what we wanted to do musically. And it just happened to kind of be right.
Yeah, the cusp.
In the middle of where everyone, what everyone wanted to hear in the scene.
Exactly.
Yet, its own voice, creative, different than its own thing, sounded different than other bands.
It was a pretty bad time for New York hardcore, I think, for the most part. You know, except, you know, you had the Cro-Mags and stuff still, but it was just kind of like a wasteland until New York found its sound again. And, you know, we played the matinees as token entry. It was just like, you know, we just get horrible responses, you know, and just plugging away and plugging away. And then finally I played a show with these guys and it was just like, you know, boom, it just was an unbelievable feeling. Massimo Ranieri, I like Jim Roselli.
How did you come across these singers?
I used to listen to Jim Roselli once in a while, and then I used to go down to Mulberry Street, the little Italian place, and they had the southern songs, basically. So I would just pick up the tapes, and then I'd buy CDs of the guys that were on it. And then I got a couple of really cool ones. I can't remember the names of the guys, but they were Italian hits from the 50s. They're really, some of them like total, like, you know, rip-offs of like some doo-wop stuff, but a lot of it is really cool, cool stuff like the soundtrack from Big Night. There's a lot of good stuff on that.
There's a lot of that stuff in my house. For me, it was, you know, it's tremendous music, but for me at the time when I was exposed to that, it was kind of gimmick, you know? It was like something way out of left field, you know, the Italian Mouse.
Which song do you think most defines the band?
I think the whole feeling of Three Steps Back is definitely encapsulated in Mingus.
AKB's got like got a good riff in it.
CD, the CDs and the vinyl. The cool thing about the vinyl is, aside from the classic black, right, it comes in
white, red, and green.
White, red. Was there,
that's right.
Was there a conscious or symbolic choice to these
absolutely
colors?
John Franco put it out, Italian American.
So where can people get this album?
DeadCityRecords.com.
Revelation HQ.
Revelation Records.
Now, two of you have are involved in a new band.
That's Chris and I. We're in a band called Kings Destroyed. It's a little bit different than Killing Time. It's on the much heavier kind of tip, you know, hardcore energy, but more, you know, more harping back to some of the stuff that we grew up with, like stuff like Black Sabbath.
We'll be right back.
And where can people go to find out more?
Kings Destroy on Facebook. It can be found also on a record label called Maple Forum Records, or on iTunes.
Or you could tweet them.
I think
tweet call.
Well, thanks for coming to spend time with us.
Okay, thank you.
Come see more about Italian Americans in hardcore and other Italian American music at the Calandra Institute's forthcoming symposium, Hybrid Moments, Italian Americans in Alternative Music. And Carl will be part of the panel.
Ciao.
From the Second Chance Saloon in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, for Italics, I'm Lucia Grillo.
Start to sing, la di da, ho ho ho. Now you're singing with a swing, singing with a swing. Do 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 do